Time for 5 good minutes with ESPN NBA analyst Brian Windhorst here on the ESPN Cleveland social media platforms. I'm Matt Fontana, Danny Cunningham, and the Cavs have tied things up with a Game 2 win over the Knicks. We're here to talk to Windy about that. And Brian, just on that, what do you believe was the biggest change for the Cavs from Game 1 to Game 2? We had rotation questions. We needed guys to step up. What do you think was the biggest change for the Cavs?
I think there were three things that happened. I think, number one, they changed their defense on Jalen Brunson. And whether or not that defense was, like, that impactful, it clearly threw them off. They were expecting a zig. They went zag. And a lot of times in a playoff setting, especially early in playoff series, that can be very effective. That was a good aggressive strategy move by J.B. Bickerstaff. Two, I think the Cavs heard everything that people said about how physically they were dominated, and frankly, watched the film and watched how Julius Randle and Mitchell Robinson came in game one and just really just showed them almost no respect. They treated them like they couldn't handle it. The way Jared Allen played, it was very clear he felt it was a challenge to him, and reacted that way. I mean, the intensity and aggression that they played with, especially with their physicality, was indicative of a team that knew it was in a must-win game. That's what you want to see. That was a response. And I don't know if that, you know, probably not something that you can keep up because the Knicks were just basically shocked. It was a punch-counter-punch situation that happened in one and two. The Knicks hammered the Cavs in one, and the Cavs hammered the Knicks in two. So now we see. And then three, they got some guys on the bench to hit some shots, you know. You don't have to have high-level analysis to say when Caris LeVert makes some shots, it makes a difference. And one of the things that happens in playoff series is that everything becomes very, very reductive. Your flaws get exposed. Your strengths get accentuated. So what Isaac Okoro is as a player was out there like an exposed nerve, okay, in games one and two. I want to be clear, that is not to say that he can't still be a productive player. That is not to say that he can't come back and hit four threes in game two or game three or game four. Like, that could happen. But the Cavs have to make a value judgment, and JB did make that. So I do think he's got a choice to make there because I don't think that you throw out the concept that won you 51 games just because of one game, but I do think it accentuates what we've been talking about all along, which is if you're playing 4-on-5, you know, and this series very clearly looks like it's going to be a lower scoring series. I mean, the Cavs obviously got the number up, but, you know, in the, what was it, halfway through the second quarter, it was like 32-24, like with 7 minutes left in the half. Like, JB and the Cavs play an old school system. This is going to be an old school series in that way. And you may have to get down to the muck, but you play 5-on-4. The other team's going to use it against you. And so it made it easier to not play him because the other guys were hitting some shots. As far as the other stuff, I don't know what's going to happen with Danny Green. I don't know what to take away from that. I don't know what to take away from, you know, the way Randle kind of had a couple of bad games. I know that in New York, they still believe they're in very good shape, and they think that when RJ Barrett gets home, he'll hit some shots. And, you know, I think the Cavs are, this is exactly what I thought this series would be. I think it's going 6 or 7. I think there's going to be bloodshed by both teams along the way.
Brian, which game between 1 and 2, with the Knicks winning a close one, the Cavs winning a blowout in game two, changes the perception of this series more, if at all?
1. Because typically in a series, one team is going to slap the other team, especially if it's a competitive series. One team is going to get the other team, just going to pound the other team one way or another. You know, whether they hit 22 three-pointers or whether, or, you know, one team shoots 32% and the other team shoots 58% or something like that. That's going to go back and forth. The way game one played out is the way the series will be determined. So without having any reason for saying this other than having watched a dozens and dozens of series in my life, I suspect we will have another game or two like game two, either way. And we will have 2 or 3 games like game one, where it's a dogfight and comes right down to the end. And we have no idea the way it's going to play out. And it just comes down to who can execute under pressure. That's what I expect this series to be. I expect this series to be more played like game one. But acknowledge that over the course of a series, especially with two teams that have flaws and are kind of young and inexperienced. I mean, even, you know, Brunson hasn't played that many playoff games. You expect some variance in some of the output, again, especially in games 1 through 4. I'm telling you, when this series comes back to Cleveland, that's when things are going to be very interesting, because we know there's going to be a game 5. And the next time you see the Cavs in Cleveland, we're going to really be in it one way or the other, because it's either going to be 2-2 or 3-1. And that's going to make game 5 mean really a very high stakes.
Brian, so the rest of the NBA with a lot of series going on, we've got injuries, we've got Draymond suspension now. Of all the teams that you're looking at or all the series, is there a team that you feel is in the most amount of trouble right now, or one thing that really stands out to you from all the rest of the NBA series going on right now?
I think the Brooklyn Nets are in trouble. Here's what I'm going to say. Regardless of what people might say, regardless of what your eye tells you, I mean, right now we're doing this on Wednesday afternoon. No series is decided. Probably Philly-Brooklyn, but no series is decided. I know it looks like the Kings. Oh, my God. No Draymond. Jump the win by 45. I mean, that may happen, but if you think you know, you don't. You think that that the Lakers got the Grizzlies, you know, around the neck because Ja is hurt and they're going home? Oh, no. Oh, no. So the thing that happens in the playoffs, and I see it every year, a playoff series is not defined by games 1 and 2. Okay. Now, can you go find a series in the last 10 years and go, well, what about this one? Okay, you got me. But in general, these are series for a reason. And the way things go down in game 1 and 2, and the way things go down in games 5, 6, and 7, two totally different things. So I was on the streets in Phoenix last night at midnight, and I get screamed up on by a random Kings fan, you know, yelling at me like, I can't believe you picked I didn't pick the Warriors, but yeah, I mean, I do think the Warriors would have won the series at the start of the series. And I'm like, oh, is the series over? Is the series over? I didn't know the series was over. So, like, that guy may be right. In 5 days, you know, he may come back to me and be able to really get into me. But nothing's over. We are only at the beginning. 1 week from now, when you guys and I come and do this again next Wednesday, you can look back at where we were today. You're going to be like, oh, my God, how did we possibly think that way when it's now? Because that's the nature of what we got here this time of year.
We do love this time of the year, Brian. Of course, opening round of the NBA playoffs going on, a lot of games. And one of my favorite things, you got a game, 2 games, 3 games every single night, a lot of drama. We certainly appreciate the time, and I can't wait because, Brian, I'm going to remember next week, I'm going to ask you the same question, and we will bring it up to see where we're at with everything around the NBA. Appreciate it. Of course, we're heading to New York now with Madison Square Garden for the Cavs and the Knicks, and we'll recap all of it next week right here on 5 Good Minutes with ESPN NBA analyst Brian Windhorst.